So I'm going to take a bit of a step back and speak more generally about the role of science in environmental policy, but in particularly in the ESA. And I'm going to sort of divide my talk into two parts. One is really to kind of speak about the general aspects of sort of the promises and pitfalls of how to incorporate science and scientific information into these difficult policy decisions, but then to look at specific aspects of the Act, both in terms of how it's designed and how it's playing out in practice, to examine some of these issues. So, I mean, this Act is no different from a lot of environmental policy in the sense that it does subscribe into, or it is built on the premise that scientific information will inform certain elements of it. It doesn't mean that the ultimate decisions will be made using scientific information alone. There's lots of other considerations that need to be brought in, obviously, but that science does play a role in it. And there's various roles. So, for example, in the ESA, when you're talking about endangered species, to identify or define a problem, so in that case to decide that there are certain species that are in some danger of some sort, and so that sort of signifies the problem. And then you can also use science to sort of get at what is causing the problem that you've identified, and so how would you then tailor some solutions to help solve that. And then once the policy is in place, then there's also the notion of how well is it going, how well are the interventions that have been designed, how are they actually making a damn bit of difference, and you know, can we monitor success and sort of progress on that and then actually adjust as we need to. So those are the various places where science will have a role. And accordingly, many of the statutes, it feels just hugely loud to me. Accordingly, many of the statutes are deliberately designed in the statute itself, so in the legislation, to decide or to subscribe where or prescribe where the science is going to inform certain elements of the cycle, as it were. But then also in the policy that comes out beyond that legislation, and that's certainly the case with the ASA, making those similar decisions. And so there is a fairly good sense among decision makers about where the science is incorporated and where the ultimate and the role that it might play in the ultimate decision. So the perspective that I'm bringing in here is mainly from the practice of incorporating science into some of these processes, but it's an entirely outsider perspective, and I do have to express a disappointment that we don't have the inside science perspective from the ministry, because there is so much capacity within it. And that is a central piece of this puzzle, which I'm going to be talking about in a minute, that we don't always know how that all works. And so my remarks are basically going to be looking at how the Act is designed and how it plays out in practice in certain elements. Also general to comments is sort of, you know, it's worthy of looking at what is science. And you know, even my remarks so far have identified it as kind of a product. There's science, magic science. But it's a process. And it's not a linear process. We'd like it to be a process where you're sort of seeking the truth and you get to the truth and then all things happen from that. And of course, that's not the case. It's actually really circular and whizzing around, and it wants to be, and it thrives on uncertainty, and sort of the whole notion is sort of a collision of opinions and trying to get closer to being able to get to close down on that certainty, but in the end it's really very iterative and messy. And that's okay, you know. But it's not okay from a policy standpoint, because the messiness is really actually not that enjoyable, because you're seeking kind of an answer to problems that have been identified, and then you know the policy is going to be written and designed in such a way as to seek the answer and then decide how to do it accordingly. So the best that it can do is basically look at the best available information that's there at the time and the guidance. And this is also a messy process, because those that are in charge of sort of bringing the science to the table will have to engage in a lot of judgments, inferences, maybe not directly about the problem, but in looking for insight from other sort of similar problems, looking at the weight of evidence and all such things. And there are going to be times where there's been a lot of study, and the conclusions are fairly much in the same direction, so that it isn't so messy. But then there's going to be other times where there hasn't been hardly any study at all that's relevant to the topic, and so you're kind of grasping at straws in that regard. Or if there has been study, you've come out with some conflicting answers. And so that's the messiness of how the scientific incorporation gets brought in. And so uncertainty is just a fact. It's there all the time, and some uncertainty it's more than others, but uncertainty is common, and grappling with it, uncertainty is a real challenge. And you know, again, you can have a lot of uncertainty when there's not enough information that's been gathered, or you can have a lot of uncertainty when you're not able to actually, you can tell that there's a problem, but you can't, for various reasons, be able to determine exactly why there's a problem. So from an endangered species perspective, we have quite a few species where it seems the signals are pretty clear that there are declines going on, and the declines, there might even be quite a bit of information that the declines are rather steep. But what's causing those declines becomes more and more difficult, A, because we haven't set up our systems well enough to monitor, but also because there's so many accumulating and synergistic issues going on out there that it becomes very difficult to be able to relate cause and effect and such things, and scientific inquiry either hasn't been set up appropriately, or it just takes so much study that you won't be able to get to that decision with any kind of definitiveness. So that uncertainty is a reality, but what the real challenge is that uncertainty often becomes a magnet receives laser focus when a conclusion that's been derived from it with couched in that uncertainty is politically unpalatable. So if it's leading to decisions that really are going to be hurtful from a socioeconomic standpoint or whatever, and everybody knows what I'm talking about with respect to species. So in that case, it's absolutely vital that scientists become very open about what the uncertainty is, and the scientific information that's incorporated is really transparent from that standpoint. But it's equally vital that policymakers don't use that uncertainty as an excuse not to act or to defer action. And indeed, twice in the act, that exact caution, both in the preamble and elsewhere, is said that you know, uncertainty in and of itself is not a reason to defer action. And it is certainly laudable, but you know, practically speaking, it still leaves you in the same boat about what to do at that uncertainty. And so at the end of the day, it does become a value-based decision about where to put the burden of proof and how much proof is required in order to act, or how much needs to occur does a situation need to deteriorate before action is actually necessary. And that is an entirely value-based decision. So if we look at Ontario's ESA and look where in the legislation science is mentioned, it's in various places. The preamble, as I said, and very specifically when it relates to both the listing and also development of recovery strategies. And then back down in the sort of bottom of the act, in sort of where the authorizations piece is, permits and agreements and whatever, there are various conditions and types of situations, particularly when exemptions are coming forward, where scientific opinion is deliberately etched into the act in terms of how it's got to be looked at. So that there is this underlying rationale into how the act is constructed about separating the scientific considerations from the socioeconomic considerations, and there are some very good reasons for that. Many of which I can't necessarily have time to get into, but one of them is the idea that if the ultimate decision is made that isn't in keeping with the sort of the best available science with respect to what a species needs, that would be then transparent in the sense that you would actually be able to compare a scientific kind of diagnosis versus what was actually decided to do to see how far off they were from one another. And of course, that becomes important over time when those accumulate, when so many decisions are being made one after another. With respect to this, and I'm going to take just a, I'm going to talk about three elements of the Act: listing, recovery, and authorizations, although not in as much detail. And just to sort of illustrate what kind of elements would be in there, at least from my experience, to ensure that the best available information is being used in a transparent fashion. And the first is that, you know, that it does indeed need to be the best available information. There has to be a robust process that allows for the best to come to inform of that time, and then also to be able to adjust with time should information become, be enhanced. Second, there has to be a clear process for bringing in that scientific input. So it can't just sit out there by itself without having some kind of vehicle in to inform the process. And third, that if it does inform the decision, that and that obviously bring in other factors, that it's transparent in terms of what the science said and how it distinguishes from that outcome. Very briefly, with listing, I'm not going to go into as much detail as John, and as you can imagine, I have a lot of reactions to some of his proposals. The notion with that, and how it was constructed in the Act, is that that would be a diagnosis on various sets of international recognized criteria took a lot of thought to get to, and this would then be a signal of what is happening, what species are to be concerned about, and putting them on a list. And that list is not subject to interference, and that list would be sort of the starting point for actions that follow. Now, a few things about that. In terms of the criteria, these are criteria that are definitely, through empirical evidence and over time with many, many examples, seen to elevate a species, a susceptibility to severe declines in extinction, ultimately. And there's lots of examples, for example, where decline trajectories of a certain amount, once they're able to take hold and the actual underlying factors that have caused that decline are not taken care of, that the end can happen quite precipitously. And there are quite a lot of examples of that. Where rarity, this issue of rarity, if they're all in one very small place, certainly they're going to be much more vulnerable to stochastic events and other events that might cause their ultimate demise. So the thing with that, the listing diagnosis says nothing about what's going to happen, and indeed this Act is built very well to actually make those decisions immediately. And yes, while there are prohibitions that would be in place right before, there's a huge amount of time while a species is in the assessment pipeline to prepare for that, and tools in the Act to decide that what society is prepared to do with respect to some of these species that are in trouble, and particularly when you're talking about needing to prioritize your actions under a system of finite resources. And so that is how it has been. I've been on the other side, on the federal process, where the time has been taken to decide, once you get into scientific assessment, whether or not you're going to subject that species to the regulatory list. And that's even before any decisions have been made about what actions would be required. In some cases, 8 years of hand-wringing ensues. And this does not seem to me to be a particularly productive set of tasks for the ministry to engage in, to decide just whether or not it gets recognized as a species of concern on some level before you get down to actually prescribing the actions. It would be much better and much more fruitful, as has happened, to actually focus on the actions, both those that you will take and those that you will not take. Next, I want to talk a little bit about recovery strategy. The very main point that I wanted to make about Casaro, in terms of whether or not, in practice, it has been able to proceed in the manner of which the listing, which it has been designed. The one particular trend that is of concern to me and other observers is that the ministry, in being able to talk about having separate science advice, also has interpreted this as being arm's length and getting M&R biologists out of this situation. And so, for example, although there were a number of M&R biologists on Casaro at the beginning, there are none that actively work for the ministry today on the group. And I think that is to its detriment. We've lost some taxonomic expertise, much of which is housed in the government, and that is a concern. But there's also not as much ability to be able to fluidly get information from within the ministry. The people who are working are absolutely dedicated on Casaro, but it gets more and more challenging to be able to come up with really robust assessments because of that lack of connection to the ministry that is occurring. And that has changed over the years that I was on it and from my observation right now. So that is a particular concern that's going on with respect to how Casaro is being brought into the ministry process. In terms of recovery strategies, that's another place where arm's length strategies have been undertaken. In an ideal world, you would have a recovery strategy being developed pretty soon after listing, if not immediately. And that recovery strategy is a strategic look at the species in terms of what is known about what is causing the concerns that have led to its listing, and also what are the possible prescriptions for recovery actions. Of course, although the ultimate actions that do occur will not yet be decided until a government response statement is formulated, that strategic focus would allow for a more proactive sort of look at how permitting and the authorization regime would actually be undertaken. And what I mean by that strategic look is that it perhaps might not be necessary for a number of species to undergo authorizations for absolutely every activity. That it would allow you to actually take a very surgical look in terms of what actually needs to be done in what geography in order to be able to elevate the prospects for the particular species in question. And at this time, because recovery strategies are rarely developed in time, much of the work is happening and much of the action on the rather reactive process of permitting and authorizations. And that has its challenges, as Mark articulated very well. And but the problem with that is that the recovery strategy sort of gets developed outside in kind of a silo, and it doesn't actually help participate in the actual strategy around the permits and authorizations nearly as much as it could. And again, removing the incredibly competent M&R staff from that kind of work at the recovery strategy level in terms of actually producing those strategies is probably has very well-meaning intentions, but probably in the end will actually not serve the product as well as it could. And finally, with respect to authorizations, that is where things get quite muddy. In the actual act, there isn't much direction about the role of science. A lot of that has been developed along the way. There's different science that comes in, both from proponents from within the ministry. But the authorizations that happen, the decisions, it's rarely transparent from the outside as to what the trade-offs are from the perspective of species in terms of some of the decisions that have been made, and particularly how they accumulate, because we're talking about so many hundreds of permits. How does all that accumulate and translate into trade-offs for the species in question? That needs to be a little bit more clearly, or a lot more clearly articulated, because sometimes there are inevitable trade-offs. Sometimes the development that is being welcomed and that is being considered, even though there's mitigation going on with each one, they are not necessarily translating into an overall better situation for the species in question, and that needs to be looked at. Sometimes they are. In closing, I just want to give a couple of examples that illustrate the reality of sort of how science is and is not considered. And they're not about the ESA. I mean, one relates to a situation where ozone levels, where there were clear policy direction needed to be taken with respect to ozone at one point. And the science had some very good articulation based on empirical evidence on what the risks were to various levels of ozone and relating that risk in terms of, and the, sort of the response variable was number of hospitalizations above normal. And so, you know, that was the science part of the question. And a lot of the lens went to, and this situation happened in the US, and a lot of the lens went to, okay, so what does the science tell us about how much we should actually have in the policy? But in the end of the day, it was actually societal decisions about how many hospitalizations were actually acceptable. That's not a science decision. And it's the same thing about species. We may have a fairly good sense in some cases about what continued habitat degradation will do to the welfare of various species at risk in the province, but we're not going to be the ones that are going to be able to decide how far to go and how much risk to put the species under. The second relates to how much amount of certainty is necessary in order to act. And the second example that I have is recently when the volcanic eruption happened in Iceland, and there was actually no science to suggest how much ash these planes could tolerate flying over the volcanoes, even though there was some sense that it wouldn't be such a great idea, but certainly they could tolerate something. In that case, the decision was made to ground all airplanes. It was a rather drastic decision, but the societal decision, or whoever made it, it was the notion that actually any risk was unacceptable in that score. And so, again, decisions on the Endangered Species Act are going to have to be about where the burden of proof is on uncertainty, what to do with it, and how much uncertainty to accept before to act. And then, lastly, just that to ensure that, just to underscore my point that these trade-offs are constantly being taken. It's very difficult to make those ultimate decisions. But then when there are some clear direction, and particularly from within the branch of, within the Ministry of Natural Resources, where there's a great deal of scientific expertise, to be allowed to say very transparently, yes, the decision that we're making actually is going to have some consequences in certain situations. And these are what we think the consequences are. The public needs to know about this a little bit more than they do right now. That's all I have to say. Thank you very much.